It is now my great honor to introduce our luncheon speaker, Paulette Cooper Noble, who will be talking about how therapy saved her life. Paulette has written 27 books and over 1,000 articles on subjects ranging from travel, pets, true crime, medicine, and more. She graduated with honors in 3 years from Brandeis University and spent a summer at Harvard studying comparative religion before completing a master's degree in clinical psychology, in New York City. She has won 9 writing awards, including the prestigious Conscious in Media from the American Society of Journalists and Authors. Her current book, available on Amazon, and she also has a few copies with her today, is her memoir, The Perils of Paulette, My Life as a Stowaway, Tabloid Reporter, Travel Writer, Scientology Basher, and Holocaust Survivor, and more. Paulette has been married for 35 years to TV executive Paul Noble, who's here today, Paul. And the two live in Palm Beach, where she writes a column for the Palm Beach Daily News. Paulette Cooper Noble.
In 1942, in Belgium, a 38-year-old man whose only crime was being Jewish was dragged off a train. He was sent to a holding camp called Mechelen before being sent to his death in Auschwitz. He was my father. I was born 3 days later, so he never lived to see me, and I never saw my father. He also left behind a very pregnant wife, my mother, and a 2.5-year-old, my sister Susie. After I was born, my mother needed to go out, but it was very dangerous for Jews to go out because neighbors spotting them would sell the names of Jews for the price of a bag of sugar and then often steal their residence. But she went out, and yes, she was seized by the Nazis, and she was also sent to Mechelen and then to Auschwitz, put in a gas chamber, and killed. My mother was 31 years old. My sister and I were hidden, but when I was 11 months old, we were caught, and we were also sent to Mechelen to await transfer to Auschwitz. I was given prisoner number 843, listed to be on the 21st transport. Those were trains to Auschwitz. But 1 week before my sister and I were to go to the death camp, somehow we were saved. Probably I was hidden in a convent, but I wouldn't learn for 70 years why we were not on that train, along with 1,554 other Jews, most of whom probably went to their deaths. I spent the next 5 years in 4 Belgian orphanages. My aunt and uncle adopted my sister when I was 4, and she remained in Belgium when at the age of 6, I left Belgium and my sister and came to America, where I was adopted by a wonderful couple, the Coopers. I grew up in New York City and then Oriana Point in Mamaroneck. But the summer before I went to college, I made a disastrous mistake. I decided to return to Belgium. I wanted to see my sister again and to meet the few surviving relatives I had who had not been wiped out by the Holocaust. The visit was a psychological disaster. My biological mother and father's relatives came to see me, and we all sat in a room, and they all were staring at me and crying. And my mother's side said I looked like my mother, and my father's side said I looked like my father. And they also showed me photos of my biological mother and father. And I saw them for the first time, and they became alive to me, and their deaths became more real to me. And the family told stories they heard from surviving Jews of what it was like in Mechelen, where my parents were sent and the camp I was in for a month. I felt horrible for my parents, thinking how terrified they must have been and possibly also physically hurt by the commandant who ran the camp with the sinister name of Philip Jonathan Adolf Schmidt, and his assistant, a German shepherd, that he would send to tear into the terrified prisoners. My family told me stories of what happened to people like my parents when they first got to Mechelen. They were stripped naked, examined, women examined sometimes with flashlights in personal areas. They had to sign their bank accounts, homes, and businesses over to the Germans. They were left with nothing. They slept 100 people to a room. There were very few beds, so they were all squeezed together. But most slept on the floor, on straw mattresses, with food thrown at them. And they had to compete with rats for the little food, and lice developed on their bodies. They also had forced marches, where they made the prisoners walk for miles, stepping over prisoners who had collapsed from exhaustion. And then those that remained were sent on a transport to Auschwitz, where dozens of people were squeezed into windowless cars with no food and barely any water and one bucket for the bathroom. And they spent several days in these terrifying trips. And when the prisoners, like my parents, got to Auschwitz, it was worse. They were sent to showers that were really gas chambers. And when they entered, the doors closed, the latch opened on top, someone poured gas in, and some, like my parents, could have taken 20 minutes to die, falling all over each other, terrified and trying to escape as they realized that they were being murdered. And the walls still have scratches from the prisoners' desperate attempts to save themselves. Hearing all this from my relatives and seeing my parents' photos, they and their deaths became real to me. By the time I came home, I was a psychological wreck. I was extremely agitated and anxious. I had trouble sleeping, eating, concentrating. I began obsessively thinking of my own death, especially a few months later, after the movie came out, Exodus. How many of you have seen it, remember? Okay. Now, you may remember that there was a scene with Eve Marie Saint and Paul Newman, and they visit a displaced children's camp. And she says of the parentless children, they feel guilty because they lived and their parents died. When I heard her say that, I lost it. I had to leave the theater. I was crying so hard I couldn't see the screen. I cried for 3 days. It was the first time someone put into words what I was suffering from. It's called survivor's guilt. And I know that there are people here who may also have suffered from it, because it's common when a parent or sibling die or your parents divorce, the child feels responsible. And because of my survivor's guilt, I felt it wasn't fair for me to live when my parents never had the opportunity. But it was worse for me than just that I lived and they died. My relatives told me that the reason my mother had risked going out when it was so dangerous for Jews is she went out to get milk for me, the newborn, meaning she died because of me. I felt that I had killed my mother. I was so agitated. I had no tranquilizers. I took what I had, which was a half a bottle of aspirin, all that was left in there. Nothing much happened, except I realized I needed help. Unfortunately, there was no organization like NAMI, but I went to the Brandeis Psychological Counseling Center, and they suggested a psychoanalyst in Belmont, Massachusetts, and I went to him for 2 years, and he did help me stop running away from my past and to stop feeling guilty and responsible for my parents' death. I graduated Brandeis after my master's. I became a PhD-D. That's a PhD dropout. I became a writer at 28. By 30, I had 4 books out, now written 27. One recently in Newsweek. Gonna stop here for a moment to do an advertisement. My latest book, the memoirs, with the title of The Perils of Paulette. My life as a stowaway tabloid reporter, travel writer, Scientology basher, Holocaust survivor, and more. It is available on Amazon, Kindle, and paperback for $25. And I did bring a few copies here, which I'll sell for $20. Come see me after the speech. Now we come to the first book I wrote. In 1973, I wrote the first expose of a rapidly growing fascistic cult called Scientology, and sometimes Dianetics, founded by L. Ron Hubbard. I was never a member. I was an investigative reporter. And in those days, there was no internet. No one could find out what was really happening there. And Scientology was notoriously litigious, and no one dared write or speak out against them. But I did. Excuse me. So they sued me 19 times all over the world. And they put me through an aggregate of 50 days of depositions. If anyone here has done even one day, you know it is hell. But I couldn't turn people down who were hurting because there was no one else stupid enough to do this. So I began working with them to get the word out about what Scientology really was. And former members came to me and they told me how they had spent all their money and hundreds of hours in a type of supposed therapy, reliving their past lives, holding a machine called an e-meter that they were told is like a lie detector. It isn't. One former member told me how he spent hundreds of hours basically talking spirits from outer space out of his elbow. He ended up in a mental institution. But Scientologists are told that psychologists and psychiatrists are evil, so people with psychological problems are afraid to get help. So because of what I was doing, they really came after me. Besides the lawsuits, when I left my place, they followed me, they photographed me. We found remains of a tap on my phone. People who were secret Scientologists tried to date me to get information. In one case, I actually lived with a secret Scientologist whose job was to keep tabs on me for them. They robbed my Belmont psychiatrist's office and sent my records around to people. Embarrassing. They also sent 5 horrible anonymous smear letters about me to my friends and adoptive parents, and one to my serious, at that point, boyfriend's boss. As a result, he left me. There were also 2 frightening, seeming attempts to kill me, one with a misfired gun. But the worst started when the FBI visited my apartment and they said that Scientology received bomb threats and named me as a likely suspect. I laughed the whole thing off. I agreed to be fingerprinted. And then I was called before a grand jury. And they showed me 2 typewritten bomb threats. And there was an obvious attempt to frame me. One referred to books to make it look like the writer was an author. Another referred to Hitler, make it seem the author was Jewish. And I honestly said I hadn't seen the letters before. I certainly hadn't written them. And then they asked me how my fingerprint got on one of the bomb threats. And I almost fainted, especially when they told me that each letter carried a 5-year jail sentence plus 5 years for perjury, for denying doing it if the government thought I did. I was 30 years old and I was up for 15 years in prison for what I didn't do. And the prospect of prison terrified me. I'm small. I was worried about facing and possibly fighting against tough women. I was even more frightened of the forthcoming trial. Everything I'd ever done could be brought out and twisted to use against me. Every secret would come out, and the early 70s was a pretty wild time. And all this would be covered in the papers like the Daily News and the New York Post. My story would be page one fodder because I was young and attractive, and they liked to print photos of attractive women. And it was a bizarre case. A woman who writes a book exposing a church accused of sending them bomb threats. I was also afraid my writing career would be destroyed. No editor would give an assignment to somebody accused of sending bomb threats to the people she wrote about. Adding to the stress, my legal bills fighting this case cost, in today's money, $200,000. And I felt guilty costing my adopted family so much money, adopted parents. I became more and more depressed and anxious and frightened for the future. I stopped eating and actually went down to 83 pounds. I couldn't sleep more than 2 to 4 hours a night. I was exhausted. And the anxiety about what was to come was so horrible. And suicide became an obsession. I had decided to kill myself the night before trial rather than go through and make my adopted parents go through a trial. But 2 months before then, I was in such a bad state, I decided I couldn't wait. The desire for suicide was so bad I could actually taste it. If I had a gun, I would have killed myself right on the spot. And I realized I was in trouble. And I called my Belmont analyst. Now, I was on probation and not allowed to leave the state. I couldn't even go to New Jersey, and I used to make jokes with my friends, you know, who wants to go to New Jersey anyway? He came. sorry, Roberta. He came to New York, and I saw him, and he helped me calm down. He talked me out of suicide then, but I still planned to do it the night before the trial. And 1 month before the trial, the government decided not to try the case. And all this, including how Scientology got my fingerprint, this is a long story, it's in my memoir. I'll just tell you very briefly that 5 years later, and I had this over my head all those years, the FBI raided Scientology, and I was exonerated when the FBI found boxes with notes written by Scientology and Hubbard himself on their progress in framing me. They called the plot Operation Freakout, whose purpose was to put me in jail or mental institution. They came close. After those 8 horrendous months, I was such a wreck, I went into therapy again to deal with my crippling anxiety, and it worked. I'm never anxious anymore, except when I'm on a plane and, you know, starts hitting some turbulence. Finally, after 16 years, I decided to stop being an activist and live my own life for me. All lawsuits, including my counterclaims, were settled. And without pressure, I blossomed psychologically. I used to joke that in New York at that time, a woman was expected to sleep with a man on her third date. So I dated every man in New York twice. Seriously, I learned from my therapy that I ran away from relationships because I had felt so abandoned as a child in orphanages that as an adult, I was afraid of abandonment again, so I would always leave first. Now, thanks to my 2 therapies, I was ready psychologically for a real relationship. And then, as luck would have it, I bumped into a man I had dated twice 19 years earlier. And 1 year later, we were married, and we've been extremely happy now for 35 years. Paul Noble, would you stand up, sweetheart? I'm pleased to report that my sister Susie is also doing well. She married, became a widow. I moved her to New York. We're close. We talk on the phone lots. She had two children, a boy and a girl. I was always very pleased that she named them after our biological mother and father. And they have four children, and actually four and two. I'm very concerned because two of them live in Israel, and they're in their 20s, and I'm afraid they'll be called up for the war. I keep learning about my past now that I can face it. Like 10 years ago, I finally learned how I was saved 1 week before Auschwitz. There was a big newspaper story written about me and how I started the anti-Scientology movement and all that. And the article was read by a Dutchman in Holland named Peter de Hoe. And he wrote me that his father and my biological father were best friends in the Navy in the 30s. And when Peter's father found out that the two daughters of his best friend, Susie and I, were about to be sent to Auschwitz, Peter's father bribed the same Nazi guard at Mechelen, Philip Schmidt, to release us. And Susie and I were saved. Finally, I ask myself sometimes, how did I survive all these close early calls? And what if Peter's father hadn't learned that Susie and I were about to be sent to Auschwitz? And what if I hadn't gone into therapy after that disastrous Belgium trip, and instead had decided to follow my mother and die young, in my case, by suicide? What if during the months I was under indictment from bomb threats, and I gave up and killed myself, as I wanted to, instead of seeking help from my former analyst? If I had killed myself either times, I wouldn't have had so many happy years, many of them living here in Palm Beach with Paul and our two dogs, and I wouldn't have had the opportunity to demonstrate to you with my story how important therapy can be when someone is in extreme trouble. Fortunately, there are organizations now like NAMI to help them. And with therapy, life can be great again for them as it is for me now. Thank you.